I love being the pastor of a non-denominational church because in my heart, in this setting, we can come together, we can disagree on some stuff, but we can still work together. And so today I realize that as I teach, at some points you're going to agree with me and at some points you're going to disagree with me, all of you. And if I haven't made all of you have a few questions by the end of this, I will not have done my job well. That's what I'm trying to do. I want us to hear from what I call the intuitive and the intellectual side of the table. Because to me, I know you cannot reduce everything to just two sides ever. But I do it all the time. And one of the ways I do is I look at Christianity today and I see the intellectuals, people who are thinkers, and the intuitive, people who are feelers. And I believe that Christianity is a thinking person's faith and a feeling person's faith. And I think we need each other. And so today when I talked to you about the Holy Spirit, I'm not trying to thread a needle, but I do have my views on these things, and that's what I'm going to share. You don't have to agree with me. It's not required to agree with the pastor to go to church here. I know some of you are going, that's good, because I don't like some of the things you think. But I do want you to consider, and my point today is let's think, let's learn, let's unlearn if we need to, let's relearn what we need to, especially in the area of the Holy Spirit. Especially for me, coming from, I grew up as an independent, fundamental, everyone else is wrong Baptist. That's how I grew up. I'm not kidding, I'm not even making that last part up. I mean, we called it separatism. We separated from everybody else. I grew up that way. But, you know, I have some great friends who've taught me a lot in how the Holy Spirit moves. And I've seen God do some stuff that I can't explain in people's lives. And so I think it's really important that we have these conversations, and I think it's really important that you understand what you have. Because that's really what I'm trying to drive deep today, is this so that you know that you are not living your life powered by your best efforts. That Jesus lives in you because of the Holy Spirit inhabiting you and because your Father loves you. And so there are things that are already supernaturally, even if that word scares you, it's true, active in your life, but they just look natural. But they're powered supernaturally. So the Bible says in 1 Peter 4:10, God has given each of you, everyone in this room has a gift, at least one. God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to make yourself happy and comfortable. I mean, to serve one another well. Use them to serve each other. I know when you say everyone's special, then the next following thought is, well, if everyone's special, then no one's special. But that discounts the infinite creativity of God. That discounts that each one of you is very special, very unique, intended for clear purpose from a God who is infinitely creative and who is always creating. So I believe that how this works, Jesus gave us a layout of how we work together with our differing views, our differing backgrounds, our differing understandings of God, our different understandings of the Holy Spirit. Jesus' plan was not agreement. See, denominationalism is built on agreement. Birds of a feather flock together. Well, the problem with that in the first century was you had people who were slaves, you had Gentiles, you had Jews, you had politicians, you had Romans, you had people that hated each other, people that oppressed each other, all the prejudice, all the racism, and they were all following Jesus, and they were all coming to church together, worshiping God together, and there was no basis of agreement outside of Jesus died for my sins and rose from the dead. That is our unity. That's our point of agreement. Another thing I want to say before I get into what I'm going to teach on the Holy Spirit today is one of the observations. This isn't Bible truth. This is a Michael observation, a country boy observation. Whatever faith practice you became aware of God in, like in a significant way, that gave you the lens by which you see the Bible and faith and how it should be practiced. So if you came to faith in a very reserved church or liturgical church, if you in that setting realize, man, God loves me, and you begin to follow God in that setting, you are going to be predisposed to that setting. And you're probably not even here today because that's you like that other thing. If you came to faith and you became aware of God in a more flamboyant setting and a charismatic setting and so forth, then that gave you a lens by which you interpret scriptures, church experience, and all those kind of things. One of the things we have to do as we come to know Jesus and grow in our faith is we have to become aware that we're all wearing lenses. Because most of us are wearing these lenses and we don't realize it. And so that's why we're disagreeing with each other, is because I'm reading the Bible with this lens and you're reading the Bible with that lens, and we're reading the exact same text, quoting the exact same verses, and coming out in complete opposite understandings of those verses because of lenses. And it's the same issue with the Holy Spirit. It's a major issue with the Holy Spirit. Above all, this is really important, you must realize that no prophecy in Scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding. No prophecy in Scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding. What does that mean? Well, easy answer, it came from God and not them. They were a pen in the hands of God, is how I have interpreted it several times. But I'd like to spread that out a little bit. The first five books of the Bible were written by a guy named Moses. I do not believe that Moses sat down to write the Bible. I don't think he was sitting in his tent going, we're going to write a religious book here. Well, I'm going to get this out. I think what Moses did was he gathered the oral history of his people and put it on paper. And I think he gathered the things that God had revealed to him and he put it on paper. What I'm trying to say is, Moses wrote a lot of stuff down and then shared it with people. I don't think he knew he was writing the Bible. Okay? He was writing a history, something for the future, but I don't think he knew what he was writing. Most of the historical writers of the Old Testament and even the New, they did not realize, in fact, let's segment the New off of that because I want to come back and deal with Luke separately. Most of them were just gathering histories. They were researching notes that were written. They were talking to people, getting firsthand accounts or stories that were passed down. I don't think they knew what they were writing. The poetic writers, Psalms, some of the prophets, I don't think they knew they were writing the scriptures. I think they were like writing songs. Moving on, the prophets. Now, a lot of the prophets knew they had a word from the Lord. And if they hadn't have written those words down, we wouldn't have them. So a lot of what you read in the minor prophets and the prophets were actually written first and read in front of the king or read in front of the people or so forth. So I just want you to see that there's a sequence, a process of inspiration that actually, if you look at it up close, it looks pretty normal. None of these guys went into their writing room and a halo light from heaven shined down. And they're like, hello, brother. I'm writing this stuff down for the future. Now, the New Testament. The New Testament, you have historical books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and Acts. Luke, I'm going to talk more about, I'm actually going to teach a little bit on Luke next month, but Luke is just trying to get the story straight. And you read it in Luke 1, chapter 1, 1, Acts 1, 1. O Theophilus, guy I'm writing to, I'm just trying to get the story straight. A lot of people are telling the story. I want to make sure it's all documented, verified, and true. That's all. Did Luke know he was writing the Bible? I don't think he did. I don't think Peter knew he was writing the Bible when he wrote his letters. I don't think Paul knew. I think they were just writing letters to the church. Later, 300 years after, it's in the 300s, some guys would get together and they would decide which books would actually be in the Bible. They would make that decision. And that's the Bible that we evangelicals have today. The Catholics have a few more books. They have something called the Apocrypha. Now, I'm telling you all this because I'm trying to show you, I'm not trying to tell you to question the Bible. We'll talk about that in March. I'm trying to show you that inspiration of the Holy Spirit actually looks pretty ordinary in the moment and up close. And we're talking about the Bible. We're talking about a very key piece of what would become a key piece of the Christian faith after the printing press is invented, for sure. What you should do then, brothers and sisters, this is Paul telling the church at Corinth. That's a very important distinction. This is Paul talking to one church. And we get the benefit of it, but this is one church. And he says to them, when you come together, brothers and sisters, each one of you has a song, has a lesson, has a revelation, has a tongue, has an interpretation. Let all these things be done for the strengthening of the church. All right, so some of you are like, I don't know how I feel about some of that stuff. So let me run over to Eugene Peterson's paraphrase of 1 Corinthians 14 in the Message Bible. Here's what I want you to do. This is why I like Eugene Peterson. He sounds like I would say things a lot of times. Here's what I want you to do. When you gather for worship, each one of you be prepared with something that will be useful for all. Pretty simple paraphrase, isn't it? So I'm sharing this with you for a lot of reasons. A lot of people take that passage, 1 Corinthians 14, and say, this is the template and the only template for how church can be done. And then other people are like, this is never going to be the template for how church is going to be done for us. And so I want to look at this text just a little bit and show you some things about it. Just notice a few things, okay? First of all, I want you to see that what is happening in Corinth assumes preparation. There's even a passage in 1 Corinthians 14 where Paul tells the guys who are going to speak in tongues to make sure they have an interpreter, and he implies in the text that it happens before the service, not during. What I want you to see in this, in the Corinth situation, is that God gives people things ahead of time. The Bible you wouldn't have if someone hadn't written it down. Even the Corinth model, you see preparation taking place. So I don't consider myself a prophet, okay? I consider myself annoying. I mean encouraging. But this week, I wrote a sermon. The last week, I wrote a sermon for March 17th, 5 weeks away. I prayed over it. I talked to God about it. I wrote down the things that God showed me. When March 14th, 15th, 16th come, I will start going through that sermon again, seeing if God has anything to add to it. And then when we come together on the 17th, God will do what he does with it. And he will show up. And so I just want you to see, God knows, God exists in every moment, at every point in time. And so he knows what the moments are going to bring. And he prepares us for those kind of things. So I see that in the New Testament. I see preparation even in the Holy Spirit stuff. I see even, so I read a passage in Acts. There's not a book called Agabus, but there is a guy named Agabus in the book of Acts. And Agabus, and it looks like in the text that Agabus came prepared to do this. He walks up to the Apostle Paul, and he takes Paul's girdle, his belt, and he wraps himself up it and says, whoever wears this is going to jail if they go to Jerusalem. That was a prophetic word. Paul's answer to that was, my heart's breaking, but this is what Jesus has called me to do, and I'm doing it. And in fact, Paul rejected several prophetic words to go to Jerusalem, because he knew that's what Jesus wanted him to do. We have a lot of our New Testament because Paul went to Jerusalem. And so there was something that God brought out of that point. Now I want to talk to you about how to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I want you, if you didn't grow up in a faith with that expression, I want you to relax. It's okay. I am not going to freak you out. You're probably not going to do head spins before we leave around the floor. Probably. I mean, things could happen. I mean, I can't make promises. But Romans 8 and 9. And remember those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to him at all. There's either saved and filled with the Holy Spirit or lost and unbelieving. There is no in between. That's Paul. Okay? Don't panic. Okay? There's something I want to show you. Verse 11. The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. Just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by this same Spirit living within you. What I want to show you, what I want to teach you right here, is that if you believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you consider yourself someone who's following Jesus and you're open to his adjustments in your life because he's your Lord, you have faith, you believe. The fact that you have faith is all the evidence you need that you have the Holy Spirit inside of you. Okay? That's all you need. I know not everyone agrees with me on that particular angle, and it's okay. But if you start telling people that they have to have something special and they can't get something special for whatever reason, then you've put them in a place where their faith is now subject to events out of your control. Does that make sense? So that's one of the things that's important to me. If you got an amazing filled with the Holy Spirit story, awesome. I'm not questioning it. I think it's fantastic. But I do know, I will say this as a pastor, and as a guy with a lot of experience in this subject, I know a lot of people who never got that particularly awesome experience, but they're just as filled with the Holy Spirit. And there, I have a lot of reasons for that that I would love to go into with you over coffee, but I don't want to go do it here, okay? But I think there are a lot of reasons for it. So here's what I want to give you today. I want to give you some simple, ordinary ways so that you can obey what Paul said, be filled with the Holy Spirit. We're about to read that passage. But the first thing I want to give you is absolute just confidence that God has done what he said he would do. If you believe in Jesus Christ, God says he gives you the Holy Spirit. Paul makes it clear, Romans chapter 8, that there's only saved and filled with the Spirit or not. Okay? So you have to wrap your head around that. You have to accept that that's part of the deal. If you believe, your belief is evidence of it. Now, does that mean that's all you get? Like, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit, and my life's pretty mundane, and this is all I get. Is that what I mean? No, that's not what I mean. And so what I'm here to tell you is the confidence, the Holy Spirit is yours, and you can always have more. All you have to do is choose to have more. All you have to do is focus. You have to hone in on the Holy Spirit of God. He's waiting. God is always right with you, ready to have conversation with you, ready to enjoy your company, ready to give you things, ready to empower your life. The Father is always, in every moment, waiting for his child to come home. But if you live distracted, I'm giving you confidence today, but I'm not giving you an excuse. If you want the Holy Spirit, it's yours for the taking. So take it, okay? And you can have way more than you're experiencing now of God's presence in your life. Now, the next thing, Ephesians 5:17. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. Are you catching my drift here? It sounds like God wants us mentally engaged in our growth, not drifting along with the breeze. Don't act thoughtlessly. Think. Choose. Understand what the Lord wants you to do. He goes so far as to compare it with drunkenness. Don't be drunk with wine. That does put you out of your mind. That does put you in a thoughtless place. But be filled with the Holy Spirit. So I think if you're moving toward Holy Spirit in your life, being filled with the Holy Spirit in your life, confidence that you have it, focus, I'll add that to the word confidence, so you pursue it. But then following the Holy Spirit is a process of thinking and listening. Not thinking. Okay? This is what I've studied. This is where I'm at. You can disagree with me, but my point is simply this. Paul makes it clear that in order for us to engage with God, he wants us in the process. Jesus, I think, made it clear as well when he said, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. So I want to take this notion that having the Holy Spirit is a thoughtless process and a process that we have no part in but are basically puppets on the end of. I want that discarded. I would like to discard that and embrace another possibility that God actually uses your mind, emotions, to speak to you, to empower you, to show you what he's up to. That this process is something we do with God,